Thank you for the introduction. Before we start, I want to go briefly into Mark's lecture we heard earlier. And of course, I have to make some advertisement for my own employer, the Time Museum in Haarlem, which I very much would appreciate you visit if you had to visit the city. A short story is it was founded in 1783 as out of the behest of a rich merchant that left a lot of money to a foundation that set up a museum in 1780. It went bankrupt in about 1920 after someone decided in the beginning of the First World War that investing everything into Russian railways would be a really good idea. And since then we've had this sort of curatorial stasis. Now there is a rule that's been defined by UNESCO as well as the icon that any collection that is in this sort of curatorial continuity for over 50 or 60 years becomes a monument in itself, which is for most museums the ultimate nightmare because it means that you're being treated as a monument and not, well, sort of prohibited from remaining an active scientific institution. And this is something that the Berlin Museum of Naturkunde probably have addressed before it's redesigned its entire central courtyard in the early 2000s. And the consequence of this for our, in our case is that both the exterior of the building and the interior are listed, which means that we're not really allowed to change anything without first getting approval. We've got our own archaeologists in this roadkill over here. It's by far the least impressive of all the Archaeopteryxes, but we've got some nice things, and sometimes, and I'm going to go to my eventual subject, we discover some things that have been more or less neglected for 150 years. Something we discovered about a month ago, which on closer inspection appears to have been part of this. This is Hydrax Harlani, which in the 1840s was set up by a German tradesman who called himself a doctor, and it's assembled out of five fossil whale skeletons, which into a through Europe eventually ending up through America and Europe eventually ending up in Berlin, where to the consternation of Johannes Müller, the curator of the royal cabinet, the Prussian king bought this as a sort of birthday present for him. It was then cut up, and a substantial amount of it ended up in the Tile Museum, although because it wasn't called a Hydrarchos by the people that sold it here, until recently we didn't know it had been part of this display. And this is, I think, relevant for our story today because this is really one of the first stones of great skeleton displays in Europe, and perhaps also plays a part in the Dinomania that we see today. Let's go a couple of years later. This is Andrew Carnegie, a rich American steel merchant that also set up a National History Museum in Pittsburgh and ordered the museum at one point to go and find a sauropod dinosaur for him, more or less assuming that this would be over with in a couple of weeks. And really, luckily, they found one within 6 months, or within 7 months, really. Took that to Pittsburgh. At one point, King Edward VII visited Carnegie in his Scottish castle at Skibo. Edward VII was really mostly interested in the plumbing because Mons had just died and he wanted to redo Windsor Palace. But in passing, also mentioned something about the picture of a dinosaur hanging on the wall. Carnegie took this as a hint that His Majesty would like a cast of said dinosaur, had his people in Pittsburgh made a couple of casts. And the first one was set up in, was this one, which was donated eventually to the Natural History Museum, which you know might know as a rather horrible name, which was actually the first sauropod dinosaur ever on display in the Pittsburgh Exhibition Hall in July of 1904. This is the same cast you just saw. This was then unveiled on May 12, 1905 in London. And on a whim, really, Andrew Carnegie's director of the Natural History Museum, had decided to make not make one cast but five, which could then be dealt out by Carnegie to various heads of state, really as part of, and it takes some time to explain this, so I won't, and it won't ever make sense anyway, as part of his plan to foster eternal world peace. We need far more beer to make some of that. The original was then unveiled in July 1907 in Pittsburgh, and it turned out to be a really Diplodocus factory with Holland, the director of the Carnegie Museum, and his assistant visiting all sorts of places over across Europe, including this is in Paris, where he was received by the president of the Republic, Fayer, and even provoking the American Museum in New York out of something like spite or jealousy to donate one of their own Diplodocus casts to the Frankfurt Museum. So this is not a Carnegie cast, it was something different altogether. And if you see, look closely here and here, you can see that the bones are actually absent. So this caused the Senckenberg Museum a couple of problems afterward, which we'll get back to. So by now, the beginning of the First World War, we have nine Diplodoci in the world, seven of which were placed in Europe. We've got the one who sort of dropped out here within La Plata in Argentina as well. And it is interesting to see that although these made a really big public impression, in some cases the museum doesn't even want the thing to be there. For instance, in Vienna they just get a sort of a letter, oh yeah, we're going to give you this 30 meter long thing, which I didn't really have room for in the museum to begin with, so it ended up somewhere in a corridor. Because if it hadn't, it had to have gone through the portrait of the emperor, which of course was totally beyond discussion. So the public interest in this thing is huge. Most of the museums that place the public see an enormous increase in visitors, it doesn't last very long. You can say that, but it also gets a very, it develops its own meme, so to speak, in art, in literature, even in song, in plays, and this is all tied to its associations with the world of high politics, of society, of American entrepreneurism, etc. So, we haven't said that much about how it was treated scientifically up until this point, and we can say that the consensus was very much about sauropods as we see today, albeit in a somewhat more 50-ish way, with the neck held lower, it's less dynamic. If you ever seen the images of Charles Knight or David Burian, you know more or less what we're talking about, an aquatic lump of meat hoping to get extinct very soon. And there are a couple of people that have problems with this image. The first really to address this is the American Oliver Hay, who had issues with both the American Museum in New York and with the Carnegie Museum. And he proposed a radically different view of the Diplodocus instead of the elephantine upright animal that had been discussed until the time. He makes a sort of new animal of it, and basically his argument, and it goes deeper than that, but in brief his argument is, this is a reptile, why not display it as a reptile? And what he specifically boils down to is, if this was an aquatic animal, the pressure that was exerted by its feet was simply too narrow and too small to support that sort of mass in the mud. Which sort of makes sense, but you could also say that modern science had led in a different direction by claiming that the animal isn't aquatic. So it sort of depends on which sort of orthodoxy you're progressing from. It's not entirely clear whether this argument is independently developed or picked up. I think it's picked up by this man, Gustav Tornier, working at the Zoological Museum of the University of Berlin. And it's important to emphasize that because the Museum für Naturkunde, the Berlin Natural History Museum, in fact consists of three museums, a mineralogical one, a geological, paleontological one, and a zoological one. The point here is that the Carnegie dinosaur had been given to the Zoological Museum instead of the Paleontological Museum. So this was in the charge of Gustav Tornia, and he develops a radically new image and really rearranges everything about the dinosaur. Especially some of the points he says was it probably was a swan-like neck and tail had to be much lower, because when you drag its tail like that, it would have put far too much stress on the bones. The parallel he develops is not so much a crocodile like he did, but a monitor lizard. One of the things that Tornia worked with was the relative reptilian, the kinetics of reptilian limbs. So he's an expert in monitors, and as someone says to a carpenter with a hammer, everything looks like a nail. This also applies here. Someone looking for monitor-like qualities will find them eventually. Now, this has traditionally been framed as a nationalist dispute between German zoology on paleontology on the one hand and American, English, partly Austrian paleontology on the other, which is understandable partly because, in fact, in 1912, Tornia got His Majesty William II to approve his resetting of the Diplodocus in Berlin in a more reptilian fashion. Because eventually it had been a gift from Carnegie to the emperor, so you needed the emperor's approval for remounting the animal. This sort of nationalist things that went on when the Germans dug up large dinosaurs in Germany's Africa, and the response by American paleontologists, in particular William Holland, who suggested that Tornia, the Diplodocus, could never have been a real animal because its ribcage was certainly, it had walked through the trench. So this has led people to assume that this was mainly a nationalist story. What we see here is, and one of the things is that Tony also said that all the American paleontologists have more or less slavishly copied Marsh's example about the build of Sauropods without really investigating anything. Paul and Tony had spoken while he was setting up the Diplodocus in Berlin, and he also takes issue with a couple of things that are aimed at making the dinosaur more visible to the public, and some practical issues such as the fact that in Paris the tail has to be curled because otherwise it won't go through it. He was understanding behind it. Well, one of the things why this whole nationalist thing doesn't really make sense has to do, first of all, with the fact that Tornia never tries to engage the Americans in discussion. He's solely aimed at the Germanic world, and the only scientist that he really talks to about this issue is Ottenio Abel, German, what we say, one of the founders of the science of paleontology. And he really takes issue with Abel. Abel's like... is an author that's very much engaged in very much busy with engaging the public in paleontology, writes a lot of popular works, and it mostly, in my opinion, has to do with the relationship between these three people. This is Gustav Tornia, this is Otto Jeckel, also he worked until recently by them at the Geological Museum, director of the Geological Paleontology Museum in Brunner. So, first of all, to do this, let's look at the timeline. In August 10th, 1909, Tornia publishes this article about this different stance of Diplodocus, and then is that immediately followed in the month and a half afterward by a plethora of newspaper articles, popular science articles, and all sorts of other donations in the popular press. Now, this is a bit exceptional because Tornia really worked in his ivory tower of an established scientist. So he has got no experience utilizing the popular press. There are some other people at the German, in the Berlin Museum that do, notably Jeckel himself, which we'll come back to, and Wilhelm von Ranke, that Marco will be talking about tomorrow. And it's interesting to see that if you calculate these times, especially the publication time attached to the publication, that means that these must have been, especially Stenfeld, must have known about Tornius, how to call Tornius text, before the official publication of his journal, which means there must have been some sort of collusion here at work. But Stenner was a geologist at the museum in Berlin. Stenfeld had been an assistant to Tornius until quite recently. So all of a sudden you see this whole avalanche of articles about Diplodocus all supporting this position that Diplodocus had been constructed totally wrongly up until that time. What is important to emphasize is that Tornio never played the nationalist card, with one exception that's aimed at the French, but never tries to emphasize the difference between superior European science and inferior American science. So this is the image that then gets published and leads to a number of reconstructions. This is Stenfeld's fleshing out, so to speak, of this thing. And we see this thing, this sort of reconstruction taking off in Germany. This is from a series of popular cards that people could collect with their chocolate around 1910, 1911. Something's going wrong here. And we see an attempt in the popular reconstruction, particularly among paleoartists, to really tornierize virtually all the dinosaurs. So this is Stegosaurus in Tornier's reconstruction. This is a reconstruction by Charles Knight of a really comparable triceratops-like animal and the way in which it had been redone by Henry Carter, who worked closely together with Tornier. Brontosaurus, and this I find particularly interesting because this is in the journal Modement House, which was something about a magazine about housekeeping aimed at housewives. So it sort of shows you what sort of fora these people were looking for. They were really branching all over the place, which is quite exceptional for this sort of thing at the time. It becomes really, really influential when the Frankfurters have to rebuild their own Diplodocus, sort of half thing that I just showed you, into something three-dimensional. They really have to think about which sort of template they want to use, and one of them is sort of this Tornier image. And the eventual compromise they arrive at is that they have to be sort of standing reaching for the water, so they really don't have to commit themselves either way. So it's sort of something. Also, this is 1934, and well, things were different back then. But this is what it ends up on. This is unfortunately the only photo that we have. It gets into all sort of public, popular presentations, and this is all to emphasize this one point. And the one point that I think this has got something to do, I'll skip around this one. It also continues in Great Britain, by the way, but I'll skip that over. Has to do with this guy. And this guy is Potter Yekel was a paleontologist, a very promising paleontologist, right up until 1900, and then everything sort of goes south. Yekel was a very interesting figure, was one of those people that could make an enemy or a friend in 3 minutes. There's this one story, which I hope isn't apocryphal, that when he arrives for the first time in Vienna, he's met by three professors. He takes one of these professors for the butler, and just gives him a coat and his hat and everything, and that sort of scuppers his chances at the University of Vienna. And that's the sort of thing that happens continually. In 1926, he sues someone at a newspaper that someone turns out to be Adolf Hitler. You know, the sort of thing that doesn't always go right. And the interesting year of Yekel, who just arrived, he got his own professorship in the north German town of Greifswald, is 1907, in which he publishes two short pieces. One is about about science in the German Empire, which he proposes four new chairs for paleontology. This is later taken up by other people as the beginning of the Kaiser Wilhelm Institute, from which Yekel is then excluded. The other one is sort of call for papers for a new standard work on paleontology as a separate science, by which he actually means the separation between paleontology and geology, and a closer integration of paleontology and biology. This is not something met very favorably by this guy. This is Ilja Branca, appointed at the Berlin Museum with the help of Ekel, ironically, and they become enemies fairly quickly afterwards. And also, Branca is very much part of the scientific establishment of the German Empire. If you look at his first article, Jekyll is also trying to establish himself as a serious scientist, also broadening out as a sort of much broader publications, philosophical publications. He writes about the history of art, etc., which makes him to be regarded as something of a dilettante by the really professional German scientists. The problem is that the relationship between Tornier and Jekyll isn't great. Although Tornier is convinced that this closer integration between paleontology and zoology is a necessity. He writes about this later on. And I am convinced for that reason that the reason why Tornier supports this new idea of Diplodocus has nothing to do, or very little to do, with international disagreements, but much more about his own effort to support Jekyll's point rather than support Jekyll himself. The fact that he uses popular channels to do so means is also a testimony to the fact that he has very little support for this point in scientific circles, and rather tries to militarize the German the German public in order to create sort of obviousness for this whole idea that paleontology should be its own science rather than subjugated to geology. Here we have a couple of other ones. I'm really ready. This is the Berlin Aquarium. This is 1913 again, same idea. And he's very Tornier, he sort of drops the whole thing after the First World War, also for other reasons, but he's very militant and very active in supporting this first idea, this idea, and it's really the only idea he's only been very public about. So this is what I wanted to tell you, and thank you for your attention.